evening, guys. Is everybody still awake?
Yes.
That's good. So over the past few weeks, over the past few months, God has just been doing some amazing, amazing things in my life, and I barely keep up with them. And I just wanted to say that everything started with prayer. Prayer is really at the core of my heart. I grew up in a Korean church. I don't know if you guys know how Koreans pray, but when we pray, we pray. We're loud and we're persistent. You know, we have our early morning prayer meetings at 4:30, 5:30 in the morning, and our late night meetings go until 2 in the morning. And that's generally the norm for big churches in Korea. Those crazy Koreans. So, coming from that background, it was very unfamiliar for me that Western churches are focused more on fellowship than prayer. And I'm not negating that at all, because I know that our unity, that our love for one another, that's what's going to show the world that we're followers of Christ. That's what the Bible teaches us, right? So it is the best apologetic of our faith, but prayer should be the foundation of our faith. Because Christianity is a relationship, and you can't have a relationship with God without spending time with Him. And I really believe that prayer is the best thing you can do for anybody. When people ask me what I want for my birthday or Christmas, I always say, can you just fast and pray for a meal? And that's really what I want. I want people to pray for me, and that's what I want to do for other people as well. So in July of this year, I just wanted to serve my church with prayer. So what I started doing was I started going to our Sunday morning services in our church building, just to prepare the atmosphere for God's presence. And then in August, just in my quiet space, God showed me this image of all the believers around the world praying for revival at the same moment. I mean, can you just imagine how powerful that would be? Because we pray to the God of the universe, and He actually listens to us. And I knew that God wanted all of us to prepare the atmosphere for God's presence at a much larger scale. And I knew that that had to start in Christchurch. So I emailed all the churches in Christchurch to pray on the 24th of September at 7 p.m. just with the one mind and one voice that God would proclaim what is rightfully His, the city of Christchurch, and for Christchurch to start looking like the body of Christ. It's literally in the name. And that email connected me with a whole lot of people with the same heart. And a small group of three women formed, we call ourselves Reclaim Christchurch. And we've just been organizing prayer meetings and events just for that purpose, to pray for the revival of the city. And we're working towards Reclaim New Zealand and eventually global Reclaim. And it's really important to us that those meetings are centered on prayer, not guest speakers or big bands or anything like that, because prayer really is what brings dead people back to life, right? That's what revival is. That's what happened to each and every one of us. And in Ephesians it says that the power that worked in us to make us believe, that's the same power that God worked in Christ to raise Him from the dead and to seat Him at His right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but in the one to come. That is the power that is activated when we pray. And we all know that great quote, when we work, but when we pray, God works. Amen?
Amen.
One of my favorite verses of scripture is James 5:17. It says, Elijah was a man just like us. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, but he prayed fervently. This guy made it stop raining for 3.5 years and called fire down from the sky. But the only difference between him and us is that he actually believed in the power of prayer and utilized it for the glory of God. Whereas we think we have better things to do, we don't have time for it. Does that even make sense? Like, if we believe in the power of prayer, if we believe the Bible when it says that Elijah is a man just like us, why aren't we praying more like him? I think people think of it more as a chore. Oh, I should pray more. Oh, I need to pray more. I have to pray more. But the thing is, you don't really have to pray. If you don't want to, don't pray. But it's stupid if you don't. Like, as Christians, as children of God, it's one privilege that we have. We get to pray. We get to enter the Holy of Holies ourselves. We get to pray to the Creator of the universe, the only immortal one that lives in unapproachable light. That's who we get to pray to. And I pray that that idea never gets ordinary for us. A couple of months ago, I was really struggling with a sin issue, so I went to my friend James, and I said, this is what I'm struggling with. What should I do? What can I do? How do I cut this off from my life? And he said, there's nothing you can do. It's beyond your means. You have to let God work in you. And I said, well, I'm not just going to sit around and ignore my issue. This should be something that I can do, because the Bible says you have to strive for purity and pursue righteousness and be self-controlled. What can I do? And he just goes, you just submit. Like, it sounded so easy, which was really annoying, because I know that it really isn't easy, but it is that simple. That submission that he was talking about, that's prayer, right? When you keep yourself so tethered to God and he's completely in you and you're in him, the things of the world don't appear attractive anymore. And I think that's what the city needs right now. I think that's what the world needs. People that are so entangled in him that his DNA and his heart show in them. And all of that starts with prayer. So I want to challenge you guys, if there is one New Year's resolution that you make, I really want to ask you to let that be to spend more time with God. Get alone with God. Even Jesus spent time alone with God. Why shouldn't we? Pray, submit. That's your answer to you.
Gosh, you must be getting tired listening to all the messages and worship songs and things that are happening, but it's great that we can gather together and watch the new year come in and to wait with expectation for what God has in store for us. As I was listening to the different speakers, I was thinking to myself, actually, what can I add to what has been shared? Because there's already a lot that has been mentioned. But one of the things, and I've asked Patricia to share, because this past year, actually, I've come across quite a number of people who have such a strong passion for prayer. And so there's Patricia, there's Elry, and Celia, another South African lady, and the three of them have such a passion to see prayer mobilized for our city. With Samuel and his wife Victoria, you know, have been for years trying to mobilize prayer. And the reason for that is that if we are longing for a revival, if we actually believe that God is a God of revival, we also need to know that prayerlessness does not bring revival. Prayerlessness is actually counterproductive, because in a revival, whilst it is a work of God and it is something that God does, when we pray, we are actually saying to God, we are powerless to change our city. We are powerless to change our nation. We are powerless to do anything that would transform the world that we live in. However, as Patricia shared, we are more keen as Christians to try and spend time in fellowship and trying to do good works, which is just as important as being Christians and loving our neighbor. But often, again, I come from Asia as well, and those that come from Asia and Africa, you realize actually how important prayer is if we actually want to change our nation. And I've seen the power of prayer taking place in Singapore. And so what I want to touch on this evening quickly, because we don't have a lot of time, is to look at a passage of scripture, and it's going to come up on the screen, from Ephesians 1. Hopefully you can read that. I love the book of Ephesians, because for me, the book of Ephesians is the manual, a manual for spiritual battle. And Paul ends the book of Ephesians, in Ephesians 6, challenging the Christians to stand firm in the Lord and in His strength, that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. We are involved in a spiritual battle that our natural strength and ability cannot bring victory. It's a victory that can only come when we are standing in the strength of God, and we put on the armor, all the spiritual resources that is available to us, and to pray in the Spirit, in the Holy Spirit, letting Him, as the earlier Gavin was sharing, to be the guide, to guide us, that our prayer life needs to be led and guided by the Holy Spirit. And so that is the conclusion of the book of Ephesians. In Ephesians 1, which is the prayer that I'm going to look at quickly, Paul sort of in that prayer in Ephesians 1 gives an introduction to the whole book of Ephesians. And the first part of that prayer of Paul is the fact that he acknowledges that the faith and love of the Ephesian Christians was something that caused him to give thanks to God for. He was impressed by their faith and by their love. It was not a faith and love that was kept within themselves as something private, because people were gossiping about the faith and love that the Ephesian Christians had. The faith in God that caused them to depend on Him, to trust Him, to be grateful to all that God has done, but also the love for the fellow Christians. And you've got to realize that the Ephesian church was quite different with the churches that we have here in Christchurch. There was no Baptist church in Ephesus, or Anglicans, or Pentecostal. They would all meet in different homes and other locations. But the love they had was for every believer that was part of that city. There was such a strong unity within the church. And that was the starting point for the prayer of Paul, when he acknowledged that there was such a strong sense of oneness within the church in Ephesus. But then he goes on, and we go to the next slide. He then goes on and talks about the spiritual resources that was available to the Ephesian Christians. And for them to understand the spiritual resources, his prayer was that they would have the spirit of wisdom and revelation, so that their eyes would be open and that they would know that who God is. They would have a growing relationship with God. But three other things that would help them understand who they are in Christ. That firstly, that they would, let me just shift a little bit. Firstly, that they would fully understand the hope that was spoken about earlier. This hope that they had came out of this living relationship that they had with Christ. The hope of their calling, the Greek word, actually it's about an invitation to come and be part of God's family. That's the hope. When Jesus called the disciples and said, come follow me, he was inviting them to come and experience the hope that they can have in him. And that same invitation is given to us, the hope of knowing that we are part of God's family, God's kingdom, the one that God is going to come, or Christ is going to come back for and take us to be with him forever. That's the hope we have. But secondly, to know the riches of their inheritance. But the third one is where I want to spend a little bit of time in, because Patricia touched on it, and it's the importance of why we need to be praying. And that is the third part of that verse, to know what is the boundless greatness of his power towards us who believe. These are in accordance with the working of the strength of his might. Now, in that verse that Paul writes, he mentions a whole lot of power words. And if you went to the next slide, which is there, that a whole lot of power words. The first word, boundless. The Greek word, hyper, and we all know what hyper is. Someone who is hyperactive, someone who is over the top. Okay, so that's, in the Greek, it's like this over the top greatness of his power. The word dunamis, we get the word dynamite. This explosive power of God. So that Paul was praying that the Ephesian Christians would know this over the top greatness of this explosive power of God towards us who believe. These are in accordance with the working. We get the word energeia, which is energy. It's like you have a dam, you get hydroelectric power. It's creating this energy. And so for all those who believe in this over-the-top explosive power of God, there is this energy that is building up in us based on the strength, Kratos, which is only used of God, and it's the power that overcomes any resistance, any obstacle. It's a power that only God has of his might. And God's might is nothing greater than God's might. And as Patricia mentioned, it is this power that rose Jesus from the dead. Go on to the next slide. In the next slide, this power was the power that rose Jesus from the dead. So let me take you back to that Easter Sunday, that resurrection day. When the power of God came, the guards, the centurions, the people guarding the grave site of Jesus, they couldn't stand. They were all collapsed on the ground. They were fainted. There was so much power that the guards couldn't stand up under that power. And it was that power that moved the stone away, which was a really heavy stone that a lot of soldiers would have pushed it in place. That power shifted the stone, and the power made alive every dead cell in Jesus' body. And it is that power that is at work in you. I don't know about you, I'm excited. This power is made available to you and I. This same power that caused the soldiers to just collapse, that same power that moved the stone away, that same power that made alive every dead cell in Jesus, is alive in you. And it is this power that is made available when we learn to depend on God and trust him for every situation, every circumstance that is going to happen in our lives. But not only that power is made available to us, God gave all authority to Jesus. And Jesus has all authority when you are seated at the right hand of God, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and over every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. So this is not earthly powers. This is spiritual powers, because Ephesians 6, Paul says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. So everything in the spiritual realm is now under the authority of Jesus. And so when Jesus tells his disciples, all authority is given to me, go therefore, we are going in the authority of Jesus. And when Jesus says, wait till you have the Holy Spirit power before you are a witness, this power that raised Jesus from the dead is made available to us. So the question then is this: if this is true, then why is the church wasting time relying on their own strength, on their own ability, on their own wisdom, when God has called us to pray in the Spirit, to pray at all times in the Spirit, in order to see this power of God at work, so that when this power of God is at work in Christ Church, in New Zealand, and in the world, then we can truly say that Christ is building his church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Right now, Christianity is declining in New Zealand. Why? Is the church relying on our own strength, on our own ability, or are we dependent on God? Because if we are dependent on God, then we need to be praying more. We need to see this place full. We need to see the stadium being built down the road, filled with people praying for a breakthrough. Because when that happens, God is going to move in this city. And so we're going to go into a time of prayer. I'm going to invite Patricia back up just to share a little word that God gave her when she did a prayer walk. And then I'm going to have a time of prayer.
Okay, so for one of the Reclaim events that we did in November, we did a prayer walk. We split into groups and we covered areas of the four avenues in the CBD area, which is Bailey Avenue, Fitzgerald Avenue, Morehouse Avenue, and Deans Avenue. And leading up to this, I prayer walked the entire area for 6 weeks, so 6 Saturdays. So that the prayer event was my 7th, like the Jericho March. And during those 6 weeks, God really showed me a lot of images, and one that really stuck out was the image of heaven coming down to fit on top of the square. So the four avenues, and it was kind of like merging onto Christchurch. And I think I completely believe that's what's coming, and that revival is coming in Christchurch, and people from all over the world is gonna come and visit Christchurch to experience the realness of God's presence. And that really started with prayer in Acts 2, Unity.
So can I just ask for 2 prayer points? One is to pray for the unity of the church, that the church in Christ Church will be one, and pray for this bond of love to be within our churches, that we are not competing with each other, we are on the same team, and so we are all here wanting to see a move of God. So let's pray for unity. But secondly, let's pray for God to raise up intercessors, that we need to see the level of prayer increasing in the city. So for 5 minutes, can you just pair up with someone next to you and let's pray for unity, and also that God would raise up the level of intercession in the city so that we will see a breakthrough. And then in 5 minutes, I will close in prayer. So if you just pair up, and let's pray for this too.